Welcome back to Broke Till Friday podcast. We've got four people here today. And remember, if you're on YouTube, like, subscribe, leave a comment. You're on Spotify, rate it, share it with people with similar interests.
Put us in your local talent show, you know?
Put us in your local talent show. You guys that are in small town Montana, we are coming there, okay? You just email us the time and the date, and we'll show up via Zoom.
I was going to say spiritually.
For a small $4.99 fee. It's 499 gold bars.
Gold bars. Gold Willy Wonka bars. What's on the docket for today?
I don't know if you guys have seen this one.
Old ass lady. She talking about she wants some young dick. I told her it cost 200 to fuck me, so we at the bank right now. Boy, you better make that dick up until you hiccup.
Mm-hmm, and I'm going to put this dick all in your liver. You hear me?
Nigga, you better make it sliver.
Come on, Lance. Like, nah, for real. Like, I'm really trying to knock that pussy out of retirement.
Boy. You gonna make me check out my nursing home.
Your old ass better stop playing till I fuck you to death. Literally.
I wanna die.
Yeah. Come down, Lance, then. I'm gonna kill your old ass.
Really?
Yeah, how old are
you? This guy right here.
78. Damn.
Cruise off that old motherfucker on Helen.
Boy, quit running your motherfucking mouth and come get busy.
I'm coming right now. Hold on. Come here. Granny, you better not bite me.
Nigga, I'm about to take these motherfucking teeth out.
Yeah, that dick was, Granny.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, you little young nigga, you did that.
I don't know, I beat that old shit in. I ain't gonna lie, I thought you almost died.
Yeah, Daddy, I died.
Mm-hmm, you died?
Yeah.
You gonna come back to Helen's?
I'm coming back.
Okay, Granny.
Come to Helen's house.
Mm-hmm, yeah. So as you can see, I really fucked a senior citizen for $200. Her pussy looked like a raisin, and it smelled like prunes. Tell me why her old ass won the second round like she young. Now I'm beating that old pussy in. I'm shoving straight dick in this old woman. I swear to God, I'm beating that pussy in. I'm knocking dust, spider webs, and loose change out that bitch.
Yeah, so they ended up having to call an ambulance for the old lady.
Yeah.
She had a heart attack.
I mean, I'm fucking her so good. I'm seeing her light flash before her eyes. I'm still going. She's screaming. I'm not giving a fuck. I'm still beating it. Then she stopped moving. I had to call the paramedics and tell them that she fell down the stairs. I couldn't let them know that I sold my dick for $200 and damn near killed this old woman. I'm done fucking old bitches. On Helen.
I'm not going to lie. If you're like dirty talking, anyone sounds cringe. You post anyone's dirty talk online, like that shit's going to sound cringe.
You saw Adam Levine. He was like, oh, fuck, your fucking body's so fucking hot. Fuck. It's driving me fucking crazy. Like he texts like a 13-year-old. It's fucking hilarious.
Doesn't matter what age, doesn't matter how attractive you are, doesn't matter anything.
Yeah.
Could be a writer for like fucking rom-coms. Your fucking dirty talk is still going to sound cringe out of
it was quite,
outside of the relationship.
Quite possibly some of the worst stuff that I've seen so far. Thanks, Walter, for that. that was a great one. So
very
so if, so if you were single, how much money would it take for you to do the same? He got paid $200 for that, right?
Wait, how much?
You got paid $200 to
fuck
the old lady.
Granny's raisin.
$250.
$200.
And $50.
No, just $200.
Is that your limit? $250.
No. I'm saying, was it $250?
It was $200 flat.
Flat, even. No tax. No stipulation. No.
Nah.
Yeah.
Nah.
No. If you were single, you wouldn't do it for $200.
Nah.
Hmm.
Nah,
how much money would it take?
Fucking at least $1K.
Really?
$1K.
Assuming that they're like completely clean and stable.
Wait, I don't get to use a condom or anything? Like, or do I have to use?
No. Yeah. Well, let's say
regular
right,
consensual sex.
Yeah.
Just.
No. Fuck.
No.
Fuck. Oh no, dude! I don't fucking know anymore.
You don't know anymore.
I don't want to catch nothing, dude.
No. Assuming they're clean.
Yeah, they're clean. You're using protection.
Whatever.
Obviously,
you want
no babies because she's like 60.
Yeah, still $1K, I guess.
$1,000. All right, that seems a little low, but Mr. X, aka Elon Musk.
You know, I don't know. Really depends. I'm just over here thinking about what it would taste like. What services is she soliciting from me? She just wants head.
No. Everything.
Full. If you just went on a date.
She literally said,
well, first
like,
of all, she's paying for the whole date.
Yep.
And she's buying me a Lego set.
Yeah.
And
that
after
fucking
that,
Lego Death Star $600.
She's paying for the hotel.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know what? After that, I think it's a bit too much. I should be more generous. I don't know. Pay for the hotel, buy me a Lego set and $100, and you get an hour.
An hour? No. She said the whole night, dude. This guy did it so hard it gave her a heart attack. Yeah. That's what you're trying to
achieve. They called an ambulance.
The whole night is $500. That's the prices I've gotten when I've asked around.
All right. Capitalism, baby. That's how it works. And now Edward says $400. Then I say $300. And then we get a bunch of old ladies
$250. No. $2.50.
This is a reverse auction right here, basically. So remember BrokesTillFridayPodcast@gmail.com for your inquiries.
Why can't the gays just be happy?
They're not allowed to.
They're not allowed.
Biden's America. So, did you guys see that Trump mugshot?
Oh, yeah. That's hilarious.
I thought it was like an AI thing.
No, it's me too at first.
They arrested him, and so it turns out somebody leaked it, and then the press had to show it. That's it. They were holding on to it for as long as possible to keep people watching for as long as possible, which, you know, it's news, right? That's what they're trying to do. So
another one of the greats, fucking Paris Hilton, Lindsay Lohan, and Donald Trump.
And Macaulay Culkin. He's actually Culkin? He's actually the second Home Alone actor to have a mugshot, the first being Macaulay Culkin.
Oh, true.
You're right. He was in Home Alone too. Yeah.
You know what this means? If you're in Home Alone, you're probably gonna be a criminal.
There's a
fallacy.
There's a statistically significant chance of being a criminal if you were in the Home Alone movies.
A precedent has been set by the ex-president.
Precedent set, president. So, oops, my volume was down all the way. All right.
Have you seen Donald Trump's mugshot yet?
He said, handsome guy, wonderful guy.
What must it be like to have all of your skin have the same quality and texture of a scrotum? Like,
I don't think he notices it because remember, the longer he moisturizes, you're
gone, one day you're just old and you're just like, fuck, this is my body. And
like,
you're
everything, just, like, you feel however you feel right now.
Exactly.
Like, if the majority of your body feels that way, that's just how you are.
You don't feel old, right?
Remember, everyone older than you is old, everyone younger than you is a kid.
Yeah.
Regardless. Like, when I was in first grade looking up at second graders, I was like, fuck, they're so old. And it's like, dude, come on. They're all fucking babies until they're like 18. So
they're all literal toddlers.
I mean, even now looking at 18-year-old kids, you're like, what? This kid's old enough to vote, you know? But Republicans are trying to stop that. So but we had another TikTok on that end, the GOP debate.
No, I was going to say Trump's mugshot looks like his mom just told him we have McDonald's at home.
He got McDonald's at home and he was so fucking mad.
You look
pissed. Change the hoax part two. The Republican Hunger Games happened last night, the first RNC debate, and a lot of things were said. In this day and age, if someone throws out a line like,
the climate change agenda is a hoax,
normal people would be like, bitch, no, it's not. However, none of that shit happened last night. And high fucking key, why would it? Last night, you couldn't go 15 minutes on this stage without one of these Hunger Games competitors going,
God,
Jesus, God,
young Jesus,
Papa in disguise. But what happened to separation of church and state? So you all are mixing religion and policy? Huh? Well, it's okay when our country mixes God and policy, but other countries better not try it.
Get out of here, hypocrisy, hippopotamus.
Your hypocrisy is not welcome here. Anyway, none of them reacted to Ramaswamy saying that climate change was a hoax.
I don't think they give a fuck.
Tim Scott, the milk dud with eyes, acknowledged that we have a mental health problem in the country. And then in the same breath, proceeds to say,
and this is why we need faith-based mental health care in this country.
Oh my God.
Faith-based?
I thought we were getting out of praying the depression away.
Christie is not a fan of teachers' unions. He calls them the single most destructive force in American education, and some of the candidates want to get rid of the U.S. Department of Education.
I shit you not. I didn't hear much on LGBTQ rights. Correct me if I'm wrong. I don't think I heard shit at all.
There was, however, a question to Chris Christie about UFOs. Ron DeSantis was awkward as fuck. Of course, he's also cool with going into Mexico on day one of his presidency and using lethal force to take out cartel labs.
Which, correct me if I'm wrong, but is bro trying to start some shit with Mexico?
Oh, the same guy who said climate change is a hoax also said that a good way to strengthen America is to drill, frack, and burn coal.
Nice.
All them bitches are pro-life as fuck.
And lastly, all of them are so obsessed with Reagan, and they all refuse to stop paying lip and tongue service to his necrotized balls. It's truly an astounding behavior. Enough!
Anyway, that's my recap. The next debate is September 27th. It's gonna be gnarls, y'all.
I love her on TikTok. She's so funny.
She's just a blur.
She was a pretty blur.
So that was the GOP debate in a nutshell. Ramaswamy is the guy who was like, oh, the climate change is a hoax, right? And he was the first one to raise his hand when everyone was like, if Donald Trump runs, how many of you are going to back him? He went.
Former President Trump is convicted in a court of law. Would you still support him as your party's choice? Please raise your hand if you would.
Like, he was the first one to be like, I'm going to lick his nuts still, right? Even if he's, because he is a convicted felon right now, right?
I'm not yet.
Or sorry, okay, he's gonna be a convicted felon.
Allegedly felon by then.
He's the only president to have a mugshot, right? Historic. Yes. He's the only president to have been impeached twice.
And indicted.
And he's the only one to have incited an insurrection.
He got impeached twice?
Yep.
Twice impeached. Lost the...
What, while being president?
Yep.
And he didn't even win the popular vote a single time.
Nope.
These are all facts.
He got impeached in those 4 years that he was president?
Twice.
So then why did he stay president?
Because they didn't remove him from office.
You can think of it like impeachment is like an indictment, basically. It takes you to...
So they're taking him to court.
It takes you to court, and then the Congress decides whether if you get removed from the presidency by, like, I think a supermajority.
So impeachment isn't necessarily... stepping down and passing it over.
No. Bill Clinton got impeached and he didn't step down.
Correct. Yeah. It would be...
learn something every day.
Not impeachment. What's the other word?
Removal of office.
No, it's something else. I forget what it's called. But, well.
Hmm. That's what I always heard. Removal from office.
Versus...
Removal.
Yeah. I guess, right? Yeah.
Removal.
Acquittal. No, I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah.
The official may be removed from office.
Trump loves hate. Or love Trump's hate.
Love Trump's hate. So, the GOP stupid debate campaign was very interesting. It was just chaotic. And Ron DeSantis was very clearly on coke the entire time. Mm-hmm. He was just doing the coke jaw thing of like a...
DeSantis is that Florida congressman, right?
Absolutely. Yeah.
The guy that was doing the whole parents...
anti-Disney thing. Yeah. And yeah.
The one who was like, slavery was a good thing, actually.
Yep. Yep. You guys don't understand. We're giving you guys opportunities, okay? First of all.
First of all,
we got y'all working. We got y'all out of the heat.
We got you out of the African heat and into the southern heat, into which arguably is worse.
Yeah. Moisture and humidity. Because then you're in America.
Yeah, so... So that happened.
American heat.
I saw that Boondocks clip today of that field slave trying to tricking the master into whipping the house slave.
And he's like, what? Oh.
He's because he,
yeah.
Well, let's wait. We have the entire internet. So let's see.
And we have Walter to edit for us. So it doesn't matter how much time we go without saying anything.
Exactly. The story of Catcher Freeman.
I think that's a different one. No.
No, it's just.
So it was a song. There was a slave singing songs. Yeah, there it is.
It is, right?
Tobias, didn't I tell you to tell these niggers to stop singing that damn song?
Stop singing? Oh, no. Tobias told us Master Connor likes that song.
That's a lie.
Oh, no, Master. We feel niggers is too dumb to lie. But you know, Tobias is the lot of shades, and he got that sharp sense of humor.
Oh, no.
He's Master
Connor. You out here telling jokes, Tobias?
Master Colonel, please. I know you mad, but don't tell you I don't pull Tobias. If you beat him, it's like you beating all of us, but with considerably less effort on your part.
Oh, so the only nigga I gotta beat today is Tobias, huh?
We don't like to see that. That makes us work harder.
Ah, shit, fire and save matches. Maybe I'll get to bed early tonight.
Please, you hit him and make all of us scared. Make us all just want to stay here. We won't do nothing if you keep hitting him, because it's an example of what not to do. God.
Well, since you love these field niggas so much, you can stay out here and work with them for a few days. And if I hear that song again, I'm cutting both your balls off.
You guys are real fucking assholes, you know that? Come on, man, look on the bright side. You get to hang out here in the field with the real niggas.
That was fucking cherry on the cake. Amazing. Dude, the Boondocks is ahead
Boondocks
of its time.
Boondocks is so good. Yeah.
Could never happen today.
Yeah, it can.
Yeah, it was. Because the whole point was about like how absurdity. Black people tend to... No, the stereotypes that are involved in racial relations. It's extremely leftist.
Yeah. Like
I think people are too PC, though.
I think it's much further clever.
You
I think
can
it's 100% more clever
do
than
that
what any leftist can come up with nowadays.
Because the creators actually knew what they were doing.
Exactly.
They weren't just spouting out the N-word randomly.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. It's very nuanced.
It was poignant. Yeah.
Yeah, it's very nuanced versus
a lot of
just going,
just
haha.
There's a lot of scenes in there that are just them spouting the fucking N-word, though. A lot of it is just that.
But it was all like poignant.
Art imitates life.
Random. Like, it wasn't just some, like, random white... Like, the reason why the slave master was saying the N-word was because...
No, yeah,
because
that's
how it
said.
Was. Yeah. Everything it's was pointed. Everything context. Had a purpose. Like, the people behind it were actually, like, intelligent.
Historical context. Yes. See, I... I already forgot the joke I was going to say, something about reenacting the Civil War. But what's the weirdest thing you guys ever saw a bum do in real life? Mr. X?
Man. I can't think of the weirdest thing, but I can think of... I don't know. When you asked that, the thing that came to my mind
is so many that come to mind.
I saw a fucking bum open some guy's truck. Like a truck driver came to pump gas, right? He went inside. Yeah. And the bum opened up the dude's truck and stole his sandwich. And I was like, hey, that's not your fucking truck. What the fuck? And he was like, sorry, man, I'm just hungry. And he got on his bike and left.
I mean, that's kind of sad, to be honest.
That's what came crazy to my mind, man.
Yeah.
That's sad.
Be like that sometimes, man. Remember, if you see someone stealing food, no, you didn't.
No, you didn't. Someone shoplifting from Walmart? No, you didn't. No, they weren't.
Well, so here's the other thing, right? Like, I understand that there's bigger social issues and stuff like that, right, going on. But then I know that in some communities, they can go from a slippery slope from like, it's the loss and the shrink of Walmart. It's like a big corporation, whatever. But then eventually the Walmart closes and then it move out of that town and then the town just gets worse, you know?
Mm-hmm. Has that ever happened? Has a Walmart ever closed?
The reason why it got worse was because the Walmart got there in the first place.
There's been a couple.
Walmart entering a town tends to decrease jobs in the area.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's like
Walmart being there in the first place is the issue.
Has a Walmart ever closed because of loss?
They claim it's because of that, but it's actually almost never at that when you actually look into it. It's usually like, oh, the workers are trying to unionize, or
that's
it was,
happened so many times.
Or it was any number of other like factors, usually not loss, because usually most Walmarts are profitable.
They were trying to unionize the Pico Rivera Walmart, and then they shut it down because of like water leaks, but it was because they were trying to unionize.
Yeah.
And my girl found out because some of the people that weren't in the like movement came over to her store in Southgate, and then they were like talking about it, like, yeah, they're trying to unionize, blah blah blah, but like these are the people that were indifferent to it or whatever, right? And then it's like, yeah, they shut it down, because it was all the way up to the store management was like trying to get them to unionize, so they closed it. They were like, it's water damage, and then fucking like 5 or 6 months later they reopened it because losing revenue for 6 months is more profitable than fucking letting a union
than paying workers correctly.
Exactly.
Speaking of unions and holding out, what do you guys think of the Screen Actors and the writers?
They should keep at it. They got the upper hand right now. How is that? Well, for one, not only are most of the projects not getting, because like the main form of advertisement for movie projects are the people in it. So like the actors and stuff, people tend to fall in love with personalities.
I heard that fucking the Marvels might get delayed because none of the actresses can fucking do any promotion right now.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So.
Exactly. Also, because one of the things that the studios are banking on was AI art being copyrightable. And the courts just ruled that it's not. You can't copyright AI.
No.
AI couldn't start.
So that's one of the things that we're banking on, and that's really fucked them. Which, honestly, good for them.
Also, Dune Part 2 got pushed to March 2024.
Fucking.
Look at that. They delayed Dune. It. They delayed Lord of the Rings.
Everything's
they delayed
getting
delayed. Spider-Man.
Mm-hmm.
Spider-Man was not
I heard about
make
Spider-Man.
It.
Yeah. Well, Spider-Man wasn't surprising. We knew because they hadn't even
Wait,
started
what did you just
production.
Say? You said Spider-Man wasn't great?
No, Spider-Man, we already
was
knew
not
about Spider-Man.
Be completed.
Yeah. Oh. We already knew that because when
I wasn't ready.
Yeah, because when the Across the Spider-Verse came out, the studios were the only ones saying, "Oh yeah, it's going to be out by this date." Everyone that was actually a part of the project were like, "No, you know, right now we're just kind of, you know, basking in like the success of this one. We're glad this one was successful."
Oh, okay.
Blah blah blah. We haven't even started writing. Like
So you guys think the unions, the strikers, that they're going to prevail?
Yeah, definitely.
Of course.
They prevailed last time.
Yeah.
They're going to prevail again.
The workers will always prevail.
In the end.
Because, like, remember, regulations are written in blood. Mm-hmm. The only reason we have a 40-hour work week is because of unions, because people fucking died literally protesting and not working and being like, you guys are giving us 80-hour work weeks. The reason we have child labor laws, which Republicans are repealing, is because people died protesting and holding off and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So
they got carpet bombed, literally.
Yeah, they were shot by police. They were the police has been used as an arm of private interest since forever, right?
What sacrifices have these writers and actors made?
They're not making any money.
Don't they still get money off of residuals and stuff like that?
Yeah. They aren't making residuals. That's the biggest
thing.
The
negative cent residuals that they were getting.
Yeah,
like, they were negative cent residuals. So they were charged.
So that one is an accounting error. That specific one was an accounting error.
That's a glitch.
But
yeah.
But
It's not the precedent.
The Mark Prosh, who's an actor on What We Do in the Shadows, and he's he does a main role on What We Do in the Shadows.
Okay.
And he had a bit part in The Office. He said he's made more money from The Office, that one role that he had for like half a season.
Well, think about syndication and how often The Office is, you know.
Exactly, but you don't have that anymore. That's the issue. Because now everything's on streaming, so they're also, like, yeah, we're going to hide the numbers. We're not going to tell you exactly what it is. We'll give you estimates. And then off those estimates, they have much lower payouts.
No,
because they're like, we can't give you the DVD sales. Sorry.
No, that's why they do the fudging of the numbers and stuff.
Exactly.
You can also follow a lot of I follow a lot of writers on TikTok and stuff, and they keep throwing their residuals. A lot of residuals, like for the one I remember clearly is that girl that was on or that lady that was on Orange Is the New Black, basically made Netflix one of the shows that made Netflix what it is.
Yeah.
She was on like basically a full season and a half, and it totally she made like maybe a couple like $150 or something like that. Off of being there for like a season and a half.
Mm-hmm.
That's total. And a lot of the residuals were just like 0.01 cent, 0.08 cents. Mm-hmm. Very, very little. Very little.
Isn't that like per episode?
Yeah. Mm. No, the way that they pay out is they pay out at the end of a certain time frame. Yeah.
Something. And yeah, it's based off of how many views that thing has had.
The total episodes that you've been in, yeah.
Remember, we don't know because fucking Netflix is the only one who sees the actual numbers.
Well, the normal ones.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But all the things that have been pushed back, right? Avatar 3, 4, and 5. What a surprise. Avengers Secret Wars, Avengers Kang Dynasty, The Batman Part 2. So filming, it's not even going to start filming until next year. Yeah. Blade, Captain America, Community the movie, Dune, talked about that. Fantastic Four.
Oh, Community is getting a movie?
Yep.
Supposedly.
Allegedly.
No, they finally got it.
We know what they said last time.
Wait. When a movie? Craven release date. When was the Craven release date supposed to be? No, they moved it. It was supposed to be January.
I remember that.
Yeah.
And that was it.
Yeah, it was supposed to be October 6th of this year, and you know when it's coming out? August 30th now. So now that dog shit movie that we were all waiting for.
Yeah.
Madam Web. What? Madam Web is...
Madam Web's getting a movie.
February of next year?
They canceled it.
No, they have everything... Wow, they have everything done, apparently.
They have people casted. Shit.
They have behind the scenes stills and stuff. I mean,
I'm excited for Madam Web.
Well, are you? I guess we'll see.
Yes.
So Beyond the Spider-Verse.
I have to see. I don't think
I watched the cartoon growing up.
Yeah, no, I like the old lady Madam Web, but they're gonna have some young, hot, sexy Madam Web now.
Yeah, the new Madam Web after the Spider-Verse event.
So
So in the comics, a new lady came out.
Yeah,
as Madam Web.
Yeah, because the old Madam Web got killed by the Inheritors. They're these immortal vampires.
You didn't see Spider-Verse or read Spider-Verse?
Not all of it. No.
Superman Legacy, Transformers, another one, Tron, another one, another Fast X sequel,
another Tron,
another Ghostbusters, another How to Train Your Dragon, apparently a Karate Kid, Scream, No Way Home sequel.
Oh, I heard that they were gonna live action How to Train Your Dragon.
It is, yeah, untitled How to Train Your Dragon live action film.
Oh, hey. Wow,
that's so stupid though. I hate when they're like, it's a live action film. And it's like 99% movie CGI.
Well, this isn't Disney; it's DreamWorks.
No, but it's still.
It better not be like just like the first How I Met Your Dragon, but like live action. I would be so mad about that.
You're gonna lose the
charm.
The entire charm. Point of the movie, the entire point of animation is that you can do so much more than you can.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Yeah. Transformers, some Mario Bros. Sequel, two Star Wars films.
Same reason why I'm kind of on the fence just for the live action One Piece Star movie film. Or show.
I was
I'm
just kind of thinking about that, actually, the yeah. One Piece live action
so
that's going on.
So the creator himself is super involved in it, and he's like, he actually likes it. But we got to remember, you're always taking it with a grain of salt because you understand the limitations of live action, you know?
Also, it doesn't matter how much, control, not necessarily how much control, but how much he's involved. If the studios then decide to be Netflix then decides to be like, oh no, we don't care if the creator personally said this, we're just not going to do that in post production.
Well, we're not going to know until it comes out. We know it's not going to be as good as the manga or as the anime, right? But obviously, you're like, whoa, it's live action, it's pretty cool, and then we'll see what happens from there, right? So the TV series is. A lot of TV series I don't
Abbott
watch.
Elementary is getting a pushback. Oh, that's such a
Bob's
good one.
Bob's Burgers. The Boys. No, they... The Boys season 4. Season premiere delayed indefinitely. It's fucked up. Chucky season 3. Cobra Kai. The Connors. Blah, blah, blah. I don't know. There's all... Daredevil. Wow. Yep.
Daredevil.
Ooh, Daredevil. Born Again. Yes, show? Remember?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no. A show, you said.
A show. Yeah. I forgot about that. Good Omens season 2.
The Good Doctor. Cool. Season 3 writing on pause.
The Good Doctor.
The Last of Us season 2. The season premiere got delayed. The Mandalorian's delayed.
Oh, well then.
Bastards.
Do you guys watch Ahsoka?
I have not seen it yet.
I'm going to watch the first episode today.
Peacemaker and the Penguin.
Weenies, dude. Big Weenie Hut Juniors.
The Sandman. I saw some of the spoilers.
Mick and Rory. Mick Stranger Rory. Things. You sorry, Rick and Morty.
No, I'm not going to watch it.
I just said Mick and Rory. I was like, isn't that like...
I did say Mick and Rory.
The Legends.
Wonder Man.
Mick and Rory.
Mick and Rory?
See, I said Mick and Rory, and then you guys heard Rick and Morty. That's the best part.
No, I heard Mick and Rory.
And I said Mick and Rory.
Oh. Rory. Like from the Legends TV show?
Legends of Tomorrow. And it's funny because it's both of them.
What, the DC Legends?
Yeah.
Legends of Tomorrow.
Oh, okay.
So what was the weirdest thing you saw a bum do? Now that we're back on our...
I saw the weirdest thing I saw a bum do is dress up in all black, put on a hoodie, and come invite me to do a fucking podcast over here.
No, but Michael. You had some stories, you said?
Fucking shit. So I was going to somewhere. I forget where I was going. I was going to my friend's house, and I stopped at downtown in Little Tokyo to... I forget what I was doing there. Back when I was just going everywhere on Uber Eats.
Yeah. Mm.
And... I was smoked a little J, and then as I smoked and I'm done puffing it, I look up. I'm by that water fountain in front of the where the mall is at. You know.
Oh,
where
Little
the,
Tokyo.
Oh yeah, I know where.
Okay, yeah.
Is this the guy with the phone?
And I'm fucking playing. I'm fucking looking. I look up and I see a bum or I see someone like in one of the doorways of those shops to the right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's just a black guy, butt naked, jerking off.
But Jesus.
And he has just blankets on the floor and he's just pounding it. And I'm just like,
was he hard?
He was Howard, dude. He was like,
he was Howard.
Big fucking cock.
Howard
big
the
bump,
hard
big
homeless.
Big bump penis, dude.
Hard homeless.
And I was heretic. Just like, I took a second because I was like, my brain.
Isn't real.
My brain was like, what am I looking at? And I was just like, for like a good like half a second, dude, half a minute. I mean, I was just
into
like,
a nature documentary.
And then I'm realizing what I'm looking at, and then I look away, and I'm like, "That's really happening. That's crazy. It's right there, and and nobody's really doing nothing." Okay, and I just walked away, went somewhere else. Jeez.
Damn,
crazy.
That's one of the craziest ones.
The guy with the phone.
You got the phone?
The guy asked you to look something up on your phone.
Oh, that guy. Oh, my God. I was leaving the 7-Eleven. I think it was back when we were both working at the 7-Eleven.
Yeah.
And I took my bike home. I would take the blue line and I'd get off on Washington. And then from there, I'd get on my bike to the 7-Eleven on Olympic.
Yeah.
I was coming back home and it was like nighttime, dude. It was like 5 or 6 in the morning.
It was ratchet time.
And there's no one else there except this one other guy. Mm-hmm. And I'm at the stop and I'm waiting for the train. And he's like, "Hey, man. Can I borrow your phone real quick?" And I'm like, "For what?" And he's like, "Let me just search something up real quick." And I was like, "Well, what is it? Tell me what it is." And I'm like, spelled like this. And as he's spelling it like letter by letter, bam, bam, bam. And he's like, "Okay." And it's some specific name of a person or something. And then I go up and he's like, "Put images, put Google images." He's like, and it's just a bunch of women with penises, dude. Or men with
men. Yeah, he fucking got you.
But he's like, "No, dude." But he's like, "Can I borrow your phone real quick?" He wanted to take my phone and go jack off, dude.
You mean to steal your phone?
No, he wanted. He wanted to jack off because he was like, no, because he was like, "Send it to my phone then." And he had one of those flip phones. And he's like, "Send it to this phone. You think I send it to this? My number's this. And they download it, and then send it to me."
You're like,
"No, man, I don't think your phone can do that." And then I don't want to do that right now. I'm not, man. It's all good. And he's like, "All right, whatever."
I feel like I'm getting AIDS just by these
things. Man, fuck you.
Like, fuck, man.
And then he tells you to fuck off, and he's like, "You're inconveniencing me, man. I just want to get a nut today, dude."
Because Jesus. he was like, "No, I'm not trying to steal." Yeah, I was like, "What the fuck is this?"
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah, that was a pretty good one. That was another good one.
I still feel like he probably could have stolen.
Yeah,
phone,
I feel like he was gonna just steal
it. He wanted the picture, dude. Because he was like, right. after he
find the staples, print it out.
After he couldn't have my phone, he was very like, "Nah, man, just download it right there and send
you
it to me."
Just put a piece of paper.
Well,
on
I think
it
he wanted the phone, the picture primarily.
"Good sir, can you print out a picture of a trans person?"
He's like, and I remember he was trying to take a picture with his phone.
He was like,
but his flip phone didn't have a camera on it.
He's just on calculator. He's just on calculator. Why do I only see numbers?
It's a TI-80s.
Bruh.
It was an old Obama phone or something.
hand. You should have been like, dude, you know they offer new ones.
Yeah, like the smartphones.
Right
yeah.
now at AT&T.
You can go to the library and look at pornography. And no one can tell you anything.
Actually, they have filters for that, remember.
You can circumvent them.
Well, if you can circumvent them, then you already have enough technology to not have to be in a library. Because you would presumably have a VPN or your own laptop, right?
I know I was getting a happy ending today.
Yeah. So I saw a bum, like, I want to say 2 or 3 weeks ago that was taking a piss behind his van, behind the Pollo Loco, right here in HP. It was crazy. Because I was trying to pull into the Pollo
Loco. Just peeing?
And it was a fat guy. Yeah. I want to say he was living out of his van, right? He was just pissing. And I was just like, and I turned and he was just like, and then he like got in real quick. And my car ran over the piss.
You embarrassed that bum. Yeah.
I embarrassed the bum. I inconvenienced him. I have to apologize to him now.
Why'd you look at him while he was peeing?
Honestly, does somebody go into
your house, look at you in the restroom, and you're taking a piss? Dude?
No, but I wanted to
look at a bum taking a piss.
You know, if I have this door open and that door open and the
you can see the restroom.
You're basically inviting. You
just take a shit, be like, hey. Inside, down the street, be like, I'll be right out.
Literally. Yeah, we just have it closed because the cats.
Literally.
I usually have like good experience with bums. With bums. I think two experiences were
pretty good.
Not that they were good. They were bad for the bum because like they basically got kidnapped.
You kidnapped the bum?
You kidnapped the bum.
No, I've told these stories on the podcast before.
You harvested
where,
him.
Where like I was selling lamps and then someone just came up.
Took him into a car
and took him into
away?
Like a van with no windows, no nothing.
Damn.
And then they just drove off.
They fucking human trafficked somebody.
That reminds me of a Louis C.K. story. He said that he has a clip of it in his show where he, remember his Louis show on FX? Yeah, so he looks out a window and he sees a homeless man on a street corner. And then a fucking car pulls up and takes the homeless man, puts him in the car, and then puts out another homeless man. A completely different homeless man just puts him there. And they drove off. They drive off.
Homeless people in shifts.
Let me see if I can find that one. Let's see. Yeah. There it is. Oh. Fucking. See the power of the internet.
On a couch.
That's the power of the internet, dude.
You're fine. Everything's fine. I'm going to have some nice eggs, and I'm going to cook for you.
I miss this show, dude.
It's all going to be great.
He didn't want to make anymore.
No, yeah, but you can't find it anywhere. It's not streaming anywhere.
Oh, you can pirate it.
I mean, yeah, but I don't have a working pirate computer at the moment.
Pirate computer.
Erk.
I don't have a plunder box yet.
Yeah.
Get hard. He's still putting out specials on YouTube, though.
On his website, too. Another homeless guy looks just like him. Look at that.
The music on this show. Man. This show in general. Excellent watch.
That would trip me out. That would really
trip
me out.
I would have thought that I got like LSD'd. I was like, someone sprayed me.
No, I'd be like,
I feel like I would have just saw something I wasn't supposed to see.
No. This is the best one. This is literally the best
one.
There's this thing on this. I guess you're supposed to.
I wouldn't do that if I was you.
Why? It says press.
So you press the thing because it says press?
Yes.
You would not have survived the camps.
What?
Why did it?
Because they're talking about Holocaust
says
before this.
Press.
Go hey, Michael, ahead.
Why would they
that
make Bobby it say
press
voice.
The arc button? Enjoy.
That lady.
Nigger.
Whoa.
No, I didn't say it.
No, I didn't say it.
I didn't say it. It's the butt. It, listen. Okay.
This show is This show is like Seinfeld, but written by Louis C.K. So.
It's fucking Arrested.
It's like Seinfeld.
It's Curb Your Enthusiasm.
No, it's Louis.
Curb Your Enthusiasm is Seinfeld, but with Larry David.
No, it is Louis. It's not like any of those other shows. It's just Louis.
This is Curb Your Enthusiasm.
It opens up with him doing like comedy routines, and then the comedy routine
so
is vaguely connected
no,
to
wait,
the.
No, wait. Seinfeld is about how comics get their material. Is that Louis C.K. is about?
No, I'm connecting the way that they're structured, the format.
I don't know.
I mean, they're not like similar in theme or even tone because fucking Louis is way more fucking absurd and surreal than Seinfeld ever is.
Yeah.
I feel like Louis is us looking at the world through Louis C.K.'s eyes.
Through Louis C.K.'s eyes. It's his little fantasies. That he said that it's his fantasies that he gets while he's like writing material.
So, but I don't think that's Seinfeld, because Seinfeld was basing it more on like reality, but on things that you're like, I cannot believe it. And then it turns out Larry David's like, yeah, I had a neighbor that did that exact thing. That's why I wrote it, you know, because it was so stupid. You know what I mean?
But still, it's like Seinfeld in the way that it's fictitious.
In the way that it's a comedy?
A fake, characterized version of Louis. Going through, you know, what he pictures and stuff. And there's opening routines and closing comedy routines that are vaguely connected to the theme of the episode. So
are there? Why don't I remember
the routines? Yeah, if you watch the episode, it'll start with him walking to the comedy cellar, giving a performance, and then the performance will cut over to his life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, well, I guess it is Seinfeld then.
I only watched an episode.
it's pretty
similar in that aspect. Not so much the tone or...
No.
Philosophy.
It's pretty good.
But Seinfeld was like the inspiration, you know?
Well, I would assume that's like saying Seinfeld is the comedian. But Louis C.K. was also doing, clubs around the same time that
Seinfeld No, I mean the inspiration was, for the show, for the format of the show.
Oh, yeah, of course. I mean, remember, how many other comedians have shows that are like, it's my life, but I just add...
That they get to like, fucking film and shoot. World build. All the weird little fantasies that they have in their head.
I don't think, no, because Roseanne had hers before Seinfeld.
Oh, yeah, Roseanne did, yeah.
And before that, you had...
I never saw Roseanne.
It's pretty good. It holds up. John Goodman. It holds up with some of them, but then sometimes they're just like, ha, you're gay. And then the entire place loses its fucking mind. Like, the whole audience is cackling. And the kid is just like, well, but I like him. And they're like, yeah, that means you're gay. And then they're cackling. Then they double down on it. And it's like, this is so sad.
What are you saying? Gay people aren't funny? Gay people can't be funny?
Exactly. No. How did you know that?
Nah, I'm but, just straw-manning over here.
No, but there's you guys have seen Hey Arnold, right?
Yeah.
Have you guys seen Hey Arnold?
I don't like it, but I've heard of it.
It would come on TV.
So right. But I recently rewatched it, and there's like, it's so fucking deep, and there's like so many adult themes.
It's really good writing.
One of the characters is a guy who escaped the communists in North Vietnam, and he gave away his fucking daughter to someone on the helicopter because they could escape and he could not.
Mm-hmm.
And then later on, the episode is about them reuniting. And I was like, what the f-? I thought this was a Saturday morning cartoon where he's like,
because
he's
football head. You know what I'd argue about that? I'd say that's cartoons are like that in general. Like a lot of 90s cartoons have an adult tone. Because cartoons back then weren't specifically... audience towards just children. It was just film and animations, especially like in Cartoon Network and other places.
Owl
like
House since
Nickelodeon and
themes.
Disney were more leaning towards children, but Cartoon Network and other places were more.
You're telling me the Grim Adventures of Billy and Mandy?
Are you telling me the Grim Adventures of Billy and Mandy are super for children too?
No, it's different. Absurd. That's more on their aesthetics. It's less for children based on their aesthetics.
I would
but
chalk
not
it
really
up
on
to
their
the philosophy of the studios and the people directing the programs. Some people, they just want a cheap, quick, and easy product that they can spam out.
Now,
like,
sure. Now
Big Mouth.
No, a lot of times. Big Mouth is because the person that produces it is like the son of like someone that's at Netflix or whatever the fuck. That's
back,
like literal nepotism.
Back then, I feel like it was like a new room. It was a new space. Like animation has existed. But to have a whole channel or a whole block dedicated to animation, they had to fill it with stuff. So they gave it to like their creators that had the most creative ideas, the passions, the guys that were willing to.
It's more because of just how much content there is. That's why. Mm-hmm.
That's
so you have
was
to
back then.
You have to play it safe nowadays.
Yeah, nowadays.
Yeah,
yeah.
Because you don't want to lose the audience's attention.
Because remember back then, dude. Even Rugrats, they had super deep themes where it's like Chucky's mom died, and then he's like, "Your mom died," and he's like, "But why?" And he's like, not understanding. But you know what? Now that I think about it, even Sesame Street had that.
Yeah,
when
Sesame Street
when
was
Mr.
always
Hooper.
About that.
No, there's
Mr. Hooper
Street
died.
There's ways to show death for children, for children audiences.
I was going
to
say,
wait.
Like, I would argue that
Arthur
some of
that
still exists.
That
it's just a little bit
the
more
Land
like
Before Time
covered
was
100%. Like, Owl House in particular comes into mind.
I mean, isn't that what stories like are? Like, dramatizations to help convey a moral or a theme?
But my point...
Nowadays, it's more like... Everything's happy, fun time, and everyone gets to be
everything's
fun.
A
I don't agree with that. Again, Owl House. Owl House. Owl House directly opposes
that. What is that?
It's a show on Disney Plus. Disney ended up canceling it because it strayed too far from that vision or whatever. Mm. But there's still shows being produced that are kind of like with deep themes and like
even Bluey and Peppa Pig have episodes like that. To be fair,
Peppa Pig is still older generation. I don't think it's new stuff.
Still being produced?
Well, Bluey. Yeah.
Bluey's definitely new.
Pretty new.
Yeah,
but I want to talk about like more about older, character. more like closer to what we're talking about, which is like Arnold or
like,
Recess.
Like yeah, Rugrats
still fits pretty clean into that.
I'm thinking like Rugrats had pretty deep themes. Arnold had deep themes, but I'm like Jenny the Teenage Robot. While it was a cool show that I enjoyed as a kid, I'm not sure if it had that many deeper themes or.
It showed
maybe
it had some
personhood.
It taught you about bullying and like being different
I feel like that's every kid's show,
that's
right?
Every kid's
but this one's like extreme because it's like a robot. You know, it's not just a girl going through her period. Now it's a girl that's a robot
changing
going through her period.
Yeah.
No, if I remember correctly, Teenage Robot was also about like body dysphoria.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say.
Body dysphoria.
Yeah, 100%.
Or like,
but
she's a human consciousness inside of a robotic body.
There was a whole episode where she wanted to change and have a human skin. Remember that episode?
That shit was fucking creepy.
But they with Hey Arnold, there's like a couple of episodes where Helga, right? Like the
one that's obsessed with Arnold.
Yeah, she's obsessed with him, but she like bullies him, right?
Yeah.
There's one episode at the end where she's talking with like her Russian caregiver, right? And the Russian caregiver seeing right through her whole facade the entire episode, and she's like, I know you love that boy, all this stuff, right? And then I swear to God, at the end of the episode, the way it ends is she's just like,
spoilers.
Your life is sad, Helga. And she gets in a car and fucks off. And then you just hear, the ending theme. And that's it. There's no fucking redemption.
No.
I swear, that's literally how the episode ends.
Because she didn't do anything to earn a redemption.
Exactly.
Yeah,
like,
that's
she's
the
like,
point.
Helga,
that's
you're
good
a
writing.
Terrible person.
Can you?
It's like, what the fuck? Like,
sometimes things don't need redemption. Sometimes things just end
but
like
for
you have to earn
show?
Redemption. You have to earn redemption. That's the point.
Can you think of any cartoons from back then that weren't that deep, that they didn't really have a second layer to them?
I would argue Billy and Mandy, generally speaking.
That did
Do you
not
think Billy and Mandy didn't have a deep theme behind it? I think the deep theme was death. Death itself.
That was the most present theme, I guess.
Nah.
But they poked fun at it. They
and
took
then, and
it and made
they
it.
Also,
into
they also toy it like I feel like they also toyed at like
the
how
mental
fucked,
illness,
how crazy shit looks in
as a child.
In,
yeah,
child.
No, I guess.
There's some like with Grimm. There's a storyline about him not wanting to be death and him having to reluctantly accept that because his parents want him to be. But generally speaking, through the overall
it's
of the show,
you know what it's teaching.
Yeah,
you know what it's teaching. Grimm in the first episode was just the Grim Reaper trying to come and reap. I think it was Billy or Mandy or the hamster or something. And then it teaches them. It teaches them like, hey, even though you're death, hang out with us, learn some humanity or something. I think that's what it teaches you. And then Grimm over the time he stops being so much as the Grim Reaper and more like a skeleton dude that hangs on the couch. That's his redemption.
Well, I mean,
that's humanity.
Even at the start,
humanity.
That's
Look
he kind
us.
Of is that. I think episode three,
exactly.
He was just hanging out on the couch. I think as early as episode
because he's
three,
their slave. Might as well just fucking watch TV.
Yeah, that's what
he's their slave, basically.
All right. Well, last topic is cancel culture good for society.
Oh, we're moving along.
This was something that Michael wanted to argue. Michael was very passionate about this.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's fucked, dude.
So,
it doesn't work.
So.
Let's begin the start.
Michael, how do you define cancel culture?
What do you mean? How do I define it?
Yeah.
How do I define it?
No.
Well, when you say cancel culture is bad for society, what do you mean by cancel culture?
People collectively choosing one person in society and ruining their lives because they all agree this person is bad and we should all just cast them out of society.
So,
and I think it's bad because people are selective. They nitpick who they want. They let some people pass and some people don't. And that's why I feel like it's flawed and it's fucked. It's like it's whoever the collective choose. It's not who is justified. It is whoever we choose to be. And there could be some fucked people
the
that they let
the
go.
So the majority of people choosing someone to cast out from society because of something they did that collective perceived was wrong.
Wait, what? Say that one more time.
You zoned out. Someone get the fucking...
Yes, give me the...
Someone
give
get
me
the kinetic
exam. You worded it a little...
So, you, this is your definition, right? When an individual is cast out from society because society decided that he did something wrong.
Right. It's right? Not just... Yeah, and I think it's flawed because people nitpick. They let people pass that they choose that have done equal something equally as fucked in society that can make them cast aside as well for the same reasons, but they're like, nah, that person gets passes, this person doesn't. This person that we're paying attention to right now is what matters. This other person that nobody's paying attention to anymore, it's fine because no one's paying attention to him anymore. He gets another pass. That's why I mean it's flawed. For that reason, I think it doesn't work. It's like
So because it's enforced unequally, basically. Yeah, so your point. Yeah. It's enforced unequally. It's
so unjust. What is the difference between what you just said and consequences?
Yes.
What's the difference?
What do you mean? I don't argue that consequences are.
No.
I want to differentiate.
Yes.
Them.
Differentiate between what you just said and the consequences of someone's actions. So like, let's say me as a person, right? Mm-hmm. Let's say I dislike something that Taylor Swift did. And I choose to vocalize that and be like, hey, I don't like that you did this. Mm-hmm. I'm telling my friends that I don't like what you did this. And then mm-hmm. she stops that behavior. And then now we're like, okay, you stopped the behavior. So now I'm going to keep listening to you. What's the difference between that as an example?
That and, is not cancel culture. Cancel culture is punitive. It's retributive.
You have to enunciate the difference.
So
you have to
cancel culture focuses on isolating and punishing the offender, the assailant. What you just described is restorative because you communicated your needs and what upset you and what was the offense. You communicated what the offense was to the offender.
But the punishment
Then the offender has the choice to, you know, accept what your needs and change or not, depending on whether or not the offender wants to restore the relationship that you had before the harm, the offense was done. So what you described
is
right
a
now,
consequence
little example,
of their actions, yeah. right?
Which so would that, still so ultimately, I'm, so in the middle of that part, you would consider that cancel culture because we are, as a collective, deciding to punish Taylor Swift for doing something we
but
don't like.
But you're not
like
restoring
her
anything. You're,
at that
you're
point,
punishing
we're not
them.
Yet.
So how about
they're
this?
Punishing them. So there isn't a difference between cancel culture and consequences because what you're trying to do
there's no difference?
Is hold.
There's no difference at all.
Not in the what you guys are. What is the difference then? Because I'm not like
we're trying to find out because you guys are the ones with the issue with cancel culture. Yeah. So we want to know where is the room for consequences and then them eventually improving if cancel culture as a
consequences
whole is bad, especially
doesn't
based off the definition
consequences
that
does not necessarily mean punishment. Consequences just means the result of an action, what comes out forth. So
and
there's consequences.
The
there's consequences.
Negative.
There's consequences for punitive justice and restorative justice. That's just. You know, what is lost, what is given up.
So how about this? So Donald Trump is being canceled right now. Am I correct?
No, Donald Trump is facing justice. He's facing the court system. The people didn't throw him there.
They did, though.
They did.
No, it wasn't.
That is the
people,
whole basis
it wasn't,
of the judicial
it wasn't,
system.
It wasn't Twitter keyboard warriors and stuff like that typing stuff out that their comments are what put him there. It was the investigations and the system doing what it does.
But you said the collective.
Yeah, the collective.
I didn't say the
Twitter
collective.
Users?
Sorry, that's what
Michael. Michael said the collective.
So what is your definition of cancel culture?
Yeah.
My definition of cancel culture?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't. It just occurred to me that I was like, I should have defined that one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But
it's pretty important to define what you're trying to say is bad for society.
Because
I would. Because I don't have a definition, I would compare it to a witch hunt.
Okay, so I don't think you guys have an issue with cancel culture. I think you just have an issue with people who are hypocritical.
Yes.
Which that we all have issues.
Issues,
with.
Yeah. I don't think that's.
Can we all agree that people are hypocritical?
But in an environment where these people are choosing to cancel and they can be hypocritical and they are hypocritical, then how is it just? Ooh. How is it actually just? It is unfair. There's people being let go
so
like nothing.
So who's someone that can fit this definition of being canceled?
Like Michael Jackson was canceled for almost all of his life, even though he didn't do anything.
Well,
ending your life as like a multimillionaire is canceled?
Woody Allen, they tried to throw him. They tried to pin a bunch of stuff on him that he never did.
I mean, it's
Woody Allen.
You can't say he never did.
No, you can say he never did it because there was a police investigation when Mia Farrow brought the case first back then.
He definitely groomed
her. There was a medical examination, there was a criminal investigation, and there was therapeutic investigation. And all of them concluded that the abuse did not happen and that, what's her fucking name? The little girl was being coached by her mother. And there's video evidence of the mother telling the little girl what to say.
So then she was groomed.
The witness testimony falls apart under scrutiny. That's it.
So then she was groomed.
The judge,
not by Woody Allen. And Woody Allen was not alleged to have groomed. What's the little fucking girl's name? He was alleged to have groomed Sue Yi, which he didn't, which is also a lie.
Okay. So real quick, just to run down the list, right? Is it okay to marry your adopted daughter?
Why is it not okay? You're laughing as if
Because it's an abuse of power.
Yeah, that's an abuse of power.
How is that an abuse of power? First of all,
you have complete control over her finances, her ability in life. Yes, as a parent, as an adoptive parent.
He wasn't her
parent. You have complete control. He was her adoptive parent, yes.
By name. Listen,
that's an explicit abuse of power.
So she was not raised by Woody Allen. She was raised by her father. She was Mia Farrow's daughter.
I understand.
Okay?
When did when did she become his adopted daughter?
It wasn't when she became. It was when they started engaging because she was not a part of Woody Allen's life. Neither was he to hers.
When did she become the adoptive daughter of Woody Allen?
But just because she...
When did she become the adoptive daughter of Woody Allen? Answer the question,
please. She's not his adoptive daughter. She's Mia Farrow's daughter.
When did she become the adoptive daughter?
I don't know when, because that's not relevant.
That's irrelevant. That's very relevant. Because the younger she is, the more influence she has.
Inherently, because he was her, under some legal term, her adoptive father, that he then had some power over her. But how does he have power over her if he's never in the same house as her?
How does having legal authority over a minor not give you power?
If you don't exercise it, then how
it doesn't are you matter. You still have that legal power.
So then how did he do it? How did he exercise it over her? Because he wasn't in the same house as her. He didn't determine what happened to her. She was Mia Farrow's daughter.
So then why did he hide it for 8 months that he was having a sexual relationship with the adoptive daughter? Because
he didn't want
married?
The lady to Mia Farrow to react the way that she did. If you
I don't want this strange old man to have a sexual relationship with my daughter. I wonder why.
Yeah, of course. Because it's seedy. I'm not arguing that it isn't seedy. I'm arguing that he didn't break the law and he didn't do anything wrong.
Okay, he did do something wrong. It's just if it wasn't necessarily illegal, it was still wrong. Those are two different things.
I disagree.
So, you can disagree, but that doesn't mean it's correct because it was still wrong.
And you can think it's correct, but that doesn't make it correct.
So, exactly. That's what I'm telling you. It's not correct. It's not correct.
Then neither are you by that same logic.
So wait. So I just really quick. So you're
he didn't raise her. Uh-huh. He had no influence over her life at all, and he did not begin to have a relationship with her until she was 21. But by relationship, I don't mean intimate relationship. I mean talking to each other at all. And why did they start to connect? Why did they start to communicate? Under Mia Farrow's request, because Woody Allen had not spent any time with her ever. He loved and raised all his children that he had with Mia, but Mia was not his child. Su Yi was Mia Farrow's child. So Woody Allen did not have any relationship with her until she was 21 years of age at the request of Mia Farrow.
So why does his other son still say that he definitely touched the daughter and
Because he's peddling the narrative.
Well, no, that other
son. So his son is peddling the narrative?
Ronan Farrow, yeah.
Yeah, he's a journalist. He's an investigative journalist.
Okay, great.
So why, if he's,
appeal
if
to
he's
authority,
an investigative
go on.
Journalist...
Appeal to authority. Go on.
You can't just say appeal to authority. Just appeal to authority. That means you have no other evidence. We already have evidence that there's a suspicious relationship here.
Correct. But your evidence is faulty.
The evidence is still there. That the fact that he was her adoptive daughter. Appeal to authority is when you have no evidence at all to base it onto which.
I do have evidence.
To.
I provided
and
evidence
I do
already.
We do too. We just did. We have evidence.
But yours
that there
is faulty
is
because
reason.
It isn't true.
You're faulty right now because all you're saying
these
is
are
like,
all witness.
Oh, this
these are all testimonies that can be.
It doesn't matter this. It doesn't matter that. But yet the fact remains that she was still his adoptive daughter. And also, you're kind of using fallacies incorrectly. You're trying to. It's called a fallacy. You're trying to use the fact.
No, I'm not. No, I'm not saying that your argument overall is incorrect. I'm only addressing.
Like, if you want to go based on these technical terms,
I'm only cutting down the fallacies as you present them. But I still haven't thrown out your entire case.
No. You're saying that.
What you're bringing up is invalid.
Hold on. No.
And when you're putting out a fallacy, I'm using.
What did you just say? Yeah, you said that we're using a fallacy, but you haven't even heard. It can't be. The appeal to authority fallacy has to be based on something that isn't evidence. It's just the word of this authority. That is not what we're doing here. So you're using it incorrectly. Mm-hmm. You're basically doing a fallacy. You're preemptively poisoning the well by saying that...
I am preemptively poisoning the well.
Just admitting to doing
because
a fallacy.
Because you're over here trying to appeal to
Ronan Farrow's
credentials.
You're poisoning the well. It's not just based on his credentials. So there's actual evidence behind what he's saying.
What evidence does he provide?
Letting us present the evidence. So that's the thing.
Other than the fact that
if you want to go with the actual terms of everything, I can do that too. I took debate class. I can do all these terms all day. That doesn't change the relevant facts of the case. Just because you're poisoning the well by saying that, how do you call it, that we're committing a fallacy yet, but the fallacy hasn't even been proven yet. Just stating that an authority is saying this, it's not appeal to authority. There has to be no evidence behind what that authority is saying, and you're preemptively poisoning the well by saying that.
Present the evidence then.
I've already kind of forgotten what the point was with you guys yelling, but
Ronan Farrow.
I know. Dude, there's a whole Wikipedia page to his sexual abuse allegation thing. But
allegations?
That's never good. No, I know. Because remember, he got acquitted, obviously, in a court of law, right?
Yeah.
But it's the same thing like OJ. Like, yeah, he got acquitted in a court of law.
Oh, OJ eventually did get in the civil lawsuit. Yeah.
Case by case basis.
Yeah.
But, okay. So, outside of someone, let's say, right?
Woody Allen is innocent.
This one's a little sticky, right?
Well, yeah, no, he technically is because he isn't in jail, is he? He never got charged for anything.
He's innocent in the same way OJ is innocent. I will say that.
Exactly. Correct. So one of the things I also presented, right?
In the same way OJ is.
One of the things I presented to Michael as well
false
was like,
equivocation?
No, why does Woody Allen still associate himself with another controversial filmmaker who actually did essay...
Guilty by association?
What's called a minor in Paris, and he's on the run. I forgot his name, right? We had talked about this so long ago.
Guilt by association.
Do you have
okay with Michael Jackson then?
So yeah, with Michael Jackson.
Okay.
So he got canceled.
Yeah,
he died a multi-millionaire.
Yeah,
was canceled. He was still incredibly successful. He is the
half
king
of
pop. Still,
false equivalency. Half of anyone that you talk to, it's either going to be they like Michael Jackson or he's a fucking pedophile. And
false
that whole and
that is not remotely
it.
True.
That's it.
That is not remotely
other,
true.
And you haven't met the other half of people.
No,
it's a hasty generalization, Michael.
I've talked to a lot of people. I've talked to a lot of people. I've
your own counsel is
he's
advising
artist,
against you.
He's an artist that I listen to. I bring him up often. And half of them is like, oh, the pedophile guy, he touched him. He touched yes, because it's a big story that's carried on them. It's
yeah,
tainted his image. It's to the point where he had to turn himself into a different person. So he had to like go and go into society and be like, hey, I'm not this person. I'm really not this person. But even then, they were trying to cancel. The only reason he didn't is because, like I said, there was nothing to really prove.
Let me ask you guys this.
So, yeah.
What is justice?
You can't define justice with one term because different people have different senses of justice. There's like absolute justice where you're like, you break the law,
true.
You're dead. And there's other ones where it's like, well, that law is unjust in
moral
itself.
Moral justice, is that maybe is that then, a better word?
Let me ask again, what is the end goal of cancel culture? What are they trying to achieve?
You tell me. Yeah, you tell me.
You guys are the ones with the burden of proof.
I don't know.
No, because you guys are the ones in this argument with the burden of proof.
Exactly.
You guys have to prove your case.
Because
the standard right now is that cancel culture is generally good.
Okay. So here's my answer. I don't think cancel culture is a real thing because people just having consequences to their actions, it's a very real thing. There are people that either double down or apologize, right?
Obviously, but for the sake of the argument, what is the end goal of cancel culture?
Well, if he doesn't believe that it doesn't exist in the first place, then there's no way he can answer that. It doesn't exist. I don't agree with that, by the way.
I think I can answer it, actually. So if cancel culture does exist, right, I think it only exists in the minds of the hypocrites that are going, oh, we have to, like, cancel this person. And then it's like, wait, no, you can't cancel them because they're so shway or what, you know, whatever they
so if it
the
only
terms
exists,
are.
If it only exists in those kinds of people's heads, does it? Mm-hmm. What is the end goal? Is the end goal consequences, punishment, or is it justice?
Well, he says it doesn't exist, so neither of those.
And it doesn't mean there's just those two answers either.
But here's the thing. I don't agree
with that,
actually.
So then what is the goal? That's what I'm trying to ask.
See, here's the thing.
So,
wait,
people growing and learning from the consequences of their actions that negatively impact people.
And how does that happen?
Because they'll reflect upon what they've done or said. Like,
actual damages to their livelihood. Actual damages to their livelihood.
People voicing it and going, hey, I saw that you said this word a couple years ago, and it hurt me. You know, I didn't understand better, but now I do. And the person goes, hey, you're right. Thank you for calling me out on that. I didn't understand better. Now I do.
What about the people who are just hide what they feel and they'll agree to the terms, but they're secretly still racist on the inside and
hypocrites.
They're secretly still pedophiles.
Well, you're describing hypocrites.
Because these people exist. You know, that's what I'm saying.
Hypocrites.
Yes, hold on. But that's also better. The less you can see and interact with and notice Nazis or any other type of like homophobes or transphobes, the better it is because the less people can actually be indoctrinated into their ideology. The less they're seen. Just look at what happened with Andrew Tate. How many less people are actually following him and stuff like that? But going back to the original point, which is what he asked, how do you call it? I think cancel culture is an actual thing, and I think there's two sides to this coin. There's people
you said
that
earlier that you agreed with him that is not.
I said I didn't actually. If you actually heard what I said.
Okay, go on.
Is that I actually don't agree with Andres that it doesn't exist. I think it does. All right. I think there's two sides of this coin. There's one side where it is clearly unjustified and there's people drumming up essentially random propaganda against an individual.
Hypocrites.
You see this. Yeah, hypocrites, basically. Yeah. You see this a lot in the right-wing circles and you see it a lot in tanky circles. Mm-hmm. I can point out to two clear instances, unlike with Woody Allen or where this actually did happen, where it's
thanks for clarifying that.
Lindsay Allen.
Allen's thing didn't actually happen. Thank you.
Lindsay Allen. And how do you call it? Yeah, I don't think he was cancel cultured. I think he's just facing the consequences of his action.
He didn't face any consequences, unfortunately.
Yeah, unfortunately, he did not.
He wasn't guilty of the
implications. How do you call it?
Lindsay Buckingham.
Ellis? Lindsay Ellis and ContraPoints both faced enough unjustified retaliation against her, against them, how do you call it, to the point where
Lindsay... she got canceled by the...
Lindsay Ellis started pooping blood because of the stress that it was giving her, and it was affecting her work and inability to produce. And then same thing with ContraPoints, to the point where she doesn't even want to debate or create content anymore because they put the stress and the effort from the cancel culture essentially following her ended up causing her to relapse back into her drug problem. And these are two instances where this is the type of negative cancel culture that I think they're going against.
That's the negative consequences of cancel culture.
But I don't think I don't think overall this is the common situation with cancel culture. Almost every time I see something happening, it's essentially what Andres was saying, which is a result of the consequences of their action. These are two particular instances where two unbelievably vulnerable people were persecuted essentially for no real or good reason. Unlike they didn't do anything specific. Lindsay Ellis's offense was that she said that the
Omega
Raya the last
she did get canceled for The Last Dragon.
Yeah, for The Last Dragon.
That it was ripping off Avatar The Last Dragon.
That's not even what she said. She just said there's a lot of similar things, similar to...
And she got canceled just for making that connection, because people assumed that she was, like, just talking about...
Yes.
And in a bad way. They assumed that she was talking about it in a bad way, when she's just like, no, literally, the structure, there's these nations, and there's this, and there's that, and they have to
there's
go
these
around.
Aesthetics that are very similar. Yes, that's basically it.
Yeah.
That's an instance where there's no evidence, there's nothing that they did, and they were still canceled for it. But the thing you don't see behind the scenes is that a lot of the people that were actually doing that weren't just canceling her for, like, a slight. They weren't canceling her for that. What they were canceling her for was just essentially nothing. They were looking for an excuse to cancel her because they had already hated her for a long time. Yeah. And a lot of the people that were on that train were right wingers who were actively against her from the start, from the off. These people had they were already planning a campaign for a long time. They hated her as a person.
There's a paper trail excuse.
Yeah. She had made two videos of this, essentially charting out the whole history of every single thing.
I remember the fucking Raya video.
And ContraPoints, the same thing happened, essentially, where I think her first offense or whatever was like having Buck Angel on, which is one of the first trans representations. He fell off way downhill.
So let me ask you. So those people, they were using the cancel culture mechanism just to punish out someone that they thought was deserving of their punishment.
They didn't really care about most of the topics. Like, you can talk to most of the people that were on this train.
Not that they thought that she deserved the punishment because she actually did something wrong, just because they didn't like her, so she deserved their wrath.
Yes,
their consequences.
Yes, exactly.
So you're kind of like you're arguing that cancel culture isn't just this one-sided sword that only works in a toxic way. You're saying that there's innocent victims to cancel culture, but then there's also another side to cancel culture, which you haven't talked about specifically right now, but you're talking about the people using it just as a sword.
Yes, basically.
Well, actually, no, you know what? I think you're right, Ben. I think that cancel culture... It probably does exist, and it's probably used for the most part for... For voicing, I don't like this person. Let's find something, whatever it is, or even if it's not true.
Example. I don't have any sources or whatever, but like what happened to James Gunn, I think that what the people that went after James Gunn just needed a reason to go after him, and then they had it. You know,
that's another one.
So then let me ask
that
this
one
because I don't think the argument was how is cancer culture bad. The question that we were answering today is cancer culture good for society? Yes or no? So. The burden of proof isn't necessarily on us to disprove it because it's not about disproving. It is just, is it good for society? Yes or no? So that's asking all of us, and it's asking what we think and why we think it. So that's why I was trying to get your guys' opinion on it as well.
Well, okay. So then let's say, assuming cancel culture does exist, I would say no, it's not good for society because it's just, again, people, hypocrites nitpicking to get someone canceled.
Would you say that it doesn't actually obtain justice? that it the possibility exists if used justly, it can lead to justice, but it in itself is not the mechanism that delivers justice.
It can be used for justice.
I wanted to bring up this example to you guys.
I wouldn't say that.
So remember, it's not necessarily, oh, justice or anything, right? Because remember, if there's consequences because someone did something bad, that's just consequences of your actions. That's not like.
But what if all those people are like, oh, she's a witch because she read a book. Well, and now she's bad, you know, like that.
The thing is that nowadays consequences for your actions are incorporated into cancel culture. That's the issue here, because
like they're blurring them.
Yes, okay. They for a while now they've been very blurred. Consequences for your actions are an inextricable part of cancel culture. If you try to criticize a politician for doing something wrong, in particular on the right wing, they will cry out cancel culture, whether or not it is justified that they're receiving that criticism.
To dismiss the criticism.
Yes, exactly. So. Consequences for bad behavior and holding people to account are incorporated into cancel culture.
Is that possible? Can you hold people accountable to their actions?
Yes, of course.
Isn't accountability voluntary? Like, doesn't the person have to voluntarily take responsibility for what they... You can blame them and punish them for all they want, but the person themselves has to say in their mind, no, I am taking accountability. I will accept that I am responsible.
No.
Well,
if you cause enough of a storm,
I'm not saying that just because they don't believe that they're wrong doesn't mean that factually, objectively, they're not responsible for what happened. I'm saying that accountability for them themselves to hold themselves accountable, they have to decide to do that. You can't force that upon them, right?
Well,
that,
if they hold themselves accountable, but you can hold them accountable, that's correct. Two different things.
But yeah. I think that's kind of like
like right now with Trump, we're holding him accountable.
Yes,
I think that's just kind of like I want to say a misuse of that phrase, because you can put the. I get what you're trying to say. You can hold him accountable for his actions by saying, no, he's the guy that's responsible, but he still has to hold himself accountable.
He doesn't have to. He can rot in a cell. He can still face the consequences.
But to be actually accountable for him, he has to voluntarily decide that he is accountable.
To reflect on
himself.
To be accountable.
But you can hold them accountable.
Not to be responsible and not to face the consequences for his actions. But for himself, he has accountability as a voluntary thing.
What are you trying to say with accountability? This is the thing with words. Mm-hmm. All definitions are made up. What do you mean by accountability?
Accountability is like how I said, like us, we can look. If I knock over a thing and you guys are like, oh, he knocked over the thing. We know for a fact that's what happened.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
You guys are trying to hold me accountable to the negative consequences of knocking that over. But it's up to me to be like, oh, you know what, guys? I'm right. I knocked over the thing and the water spilled on this and that. Or I can be like, dude, that's not my fault. I didn't put the thing there.
Then you're gaslighting us.
You know?
Yeah.
Or like, but that's what I mean. But like, yes. And you guys can hold me responsible to the consequences of my actions. But I can still, I have to choose whether or not I'm holding myself accountable, whether I'm accountable.
Technically, no, because holding someone accountable just means requiring them or expecting them to justify their actions or decisions, right? Holding someone responsible, holding someone accountable, right? Parents could be held accountable for their children's
redefine
actions.
Redefine it that the dude has to...
So accountable.
Try to justify their decisions?
Of a person, organization, or institution. Required or expected to justify actions or decisions. Remember, when we're doing that to Trump, we're expecting him to justify his actions.
Oh, the expectation. Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
which he's not going to be able to justify outside of like...
That's what it means to hold someone accountable. Or is that what it means? That's what accountable means.
Accountable.
Accountable means... Of a person, organization, or institution.
Here's the
required thing. Or expected to justify actions or decisions, comma, i.e. responsible.
Okay.
That definition is a little bit limiting, because whether or not you expect them to do that, it's kind of... it can be, not always, but it can be unnecessary. You don't need to expect them to.
No, by your guys' logic, it is unnecessary, because they're just... Yeah. The expectation is enough.
Yeah.
Because they're going to face scrutiny. They're going to face the trial.
Yes.
Yes.
It's not about whether or not they themselves take responsibility for their actions.
Yeah.
Because they're going to face the consequences anyway.
Yeah. Correct. The consequences themselves are the accountability that they're facing. So, like, let's say in that example.
The system is holding them accountable.
The system
that's
in this
how we
case,
can say it.
But generally speaking, like, for example, in the situation where you knock over the water or the cup, right? Let's say it breaks. Andres could then be like, hey, you got to pay me for the thing you broke if it was an expensive one. Like, for the sake of the argument, let's say it was a $30 cup or something. Mm-hmm. You knock it over. It's like, hey, you know, that cup's kind of expensive. You know, can you replace it? And then that's the consequence. That's holding you accountable.
And actually, to put it a little further, right? If he's like, oh, I don't want to pay you back. Well, you're not allowed in my house again.
Yeah.
That's the consequence of lack of accountability.
That's exactly where I was going to go with it.
Yeah, from your own.
And then let's take it one step further. Let's say you still don't want to be held accountable.
Lack of accountability.
Small claims court.
Small claims court.
Lack of accountability.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Can you define that?
Lack of accountability? When someone doesn't face the consequences for their actions.
No, because I'm still facing consequences because I'm being kicked out of the house.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, then you wouldn't lack accountability in that case.
No, because
I'm
holding
you accountable by having that consequence.
Because if I chose to hold myself accountable, I would have given into his needs to restore the relationship, but mm-hmm. I'm not holding myself accountable, but I'm still facing the consequences of being kicked out of the house, mm-hmm. you know? So, because of that lack of accountability.
So you're irresponsible.
I don't need to take accountability to face consequences.
No,
I can face
don't.
Consequences with lack of accountability.
So
with
lack of accountability is not a catch-all for like that. In that case, the language
I'm
that you're using.
I'm describing in his case.
Yeah,
In this case, we're holding you accountable.
In this case, we're holding accountable. Lack of accountability, you could, because this is language, right? Language can reference different things.
Yourself, so what are you describing when I lack accountability?
When
what
you
are
lack
you describing
accountability,
it?
Usually in that language, you're referencing your own self-accountability. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean we can't hold you accountable.
No, I understand mm-hmm. that. But I'm trying to argue for the individual, the
for who?
When you're saying that I lack accountability, what are you describing?
You're lacking
what
responsibility.
Am I doing? Okay.
You lack your own accountability.
Can you elaborate?
But here's the thing.
How? Like, what am I doing to...
Wait, how much more can we elaborate than saying the definition?
Well, okay, like, I feel like dictionary definitions are a little bit...
No, because this is what I mean. This is what I mean.
Okay, okay.
But
the consequence is me getting kicked out of the house for having to pay you the money.
Yeah.
Mm. Accountability would be taking accountability. Accountability is recognizing what I did, giving into or appreciating your needs to restore the relationship. Lack of accountability. What I was looking for is not recognizing what I did mm-hmm. and the way you guys did it and not appreciating your needs.
Okay. Here's the relationship. I think I understand.
In that example,
what's happening. So in language, you understand things can reference different things despite being the same word, right? So in this instance, you can both lack accountability and also be held accountable.
I'm past that. I was trying to get him to describe what he meant by lack of accountability. And I wanted the action, which was
lack of responsibility. Like
that. No, I wanted the action. What do you mean by lack of responsibility? Oh, well, I'm not justifying what you guys see.
It's not an action. It's an adjective.
Yeah, it's a state of being.
I'm trying to ask for the actions that you're describing.
The action of knocking over the cup or...
No, knocking over the cup is the incident.
Yeah.
The thing that makes me lack accountability is that I don't recognize my part in knocking over the cup,
that you
how it affects you guys and what you guys need from me to restore the relationship.
So you don't take responsibility for knocking it over and you go, I don't care, right?
Yeah.
So I go, well, then get out of my house. That's me holding you accountable. That's that's a consequence, right?
Actually,
of your
consequences,
irresponsibility.
Yeah.
Actually, speaking of what you just kind of gave me a little brain blast. So it is... Someone else holds you accountable when you yourself don't hold yourself accountable. If you have lack of accountability, another person will hold you accountable.
Yeah.
So in this instance, you lack accountability by not willingly paying back.
Accountability is transferred.
Yes, accountability is then transferred to Andres,
like
forcing accountability onto you by not letting you back into the house.
Yeah.
It's like a burden. Whereas if I took it upon myself, I would have done the thing to restore the
relationship.
The conditions before.
It's like the blame shifts or the burden shifts. The accountability shifts.
Is that... Mm-hmm. Is that the entire point of... Well, you guys aren't arguing justice. We're arguing cancel culture.
Yeah.
Is that the point? Just to have someone to point the finger to? Just to have someone to point the blame on?
I think... Well, I'm thinking that it's... In my opinion, cancel culture... The cancel culture vultures being like, oh, this person's doing this as they're a hypocrite.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's definitely a finger pointing. But on the other side, where, like I said, it blurs, if someone is being held accountable for their past misdeeds... Those misdeeds can be anything from racism, misogyny to, you know, maybe they cut off someone, right? Whatever it is.
Do people deserve to lose their... This is a different question.
Okay. Do they deserve
to
lose their livelihood?
Do they deserve to lose their lives and livelihoods because they said something racist?
It depends.
How many people have lost their livelihoods outside of Nazis, right? Because we can all agree Nazis are bad, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we've seen them go to jail because of white supremacist stuff, all that kind of stuff.
As they should.
And then there's degrees of Nazism.
You bring up a good point because I don't have any specific examples. But let me ask, what about people that get fired from their jobs
I have
for
an
saying
example.
The wrong thing?
I have an example, right? Justin Roiland, right?
Okay.
Do you guys think what he did was correct? because I will outline what he did.
See, what did he do? What did he do?
But here's the thing.
Let me say what he did, and then you make your informed decision.
I heard what happened, but I know.
Justin Roiland got fired from Rick and Morty because he was sexually harassing the female writers on the staff. Yeah. He would make racist comments as well, right? And inappropriate jokes, but I get it. It's Rick and Morty. They make inappropriate jokes. But this is, if this is inappropriate for Rick and Morty, like, imagine just how inappropriate it is, right? And he was messaging underage girls as well.
Okay.
Now, do you think he deserves to get fired for that?
This is a tricky question because I believe. See, this is the thing. I believe art should be
separate from the artist.
So Hitler's art, you're gonna be like, yeah,
right. You know what? I can appreciate Hitler's art and not be racist.
It was bad art. That's the thing. It was objectively.
But it's relative. But art, like art is relative.
Okay.
It's relative to each person. So
I understand that.
It can be relative.
It can be. But
it is.
Objective metrics.
Do you want to keep supporting this sex pest? That's the other thing.
Wait, say that again.
Do you want to keep supporting this sex pest, Justin Roiland?
But here's
I did not buy his game. I was hyped for his game.
We're supporting other things and other atrocities in the world.
But
we
No, this is the issue. No, hold on. This is the other issue.
I wasn't supporting him to begin with.
It's that you guys are kind of mixing together two things. You're mixing together supporting large institutions and your personal choice as to whether you feel comfortable supporting this person.
Exactly. Okay.
These are two different instances.
Yeah, yeah.
For personal example, I am trans. I do not support Harry Potter anymore.
Okay.
I do not support J.K. Rowling anymore. Whether or not I will be able to effectively dethrone her is actually impossible, right? Because she is the richest person essentially in Britain, and she has major control over the government through her right-wing connections.
But you just stopped consuming her
I
products.
Stopped consuming her content because she's actively trying to get me murdered in a genocide. So I do not feel comfortable supporting her.
You wouldn't be able to... You wouldn't feel like you're... Let's say you were a big fan of Harry Potter before that moment.
I was.
Okay. So you wouldn't be say you wouldn't still try to find a way to implement Harry Potter into your life without necessarily supporting her? Like maybe torrenting all her movies, not buying any of her merchandise.
Fan groups is the extent. Like how do you call it? Some of my friends still like Harry Potter, so we talk about her amongst ourselves, we read fan fiction, but none of that directly supports her, and all of them take the characters out of their intended purposes. That is not necessarily separating the art from the artist, which is, if I'm guessing correctly, you're talking about Death of the Author. It doesn't have a lot to do with that.
He's separating the art from the art.
Oh, sorry. The art from the artist.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. I was trying to say that you're taking the art away from the artist and away from the art.
Like, oh,
you're
taking it upon yourself. Basically, yes. Yeah. Yes.
Transforming into something his own. Okay.
Yes. So you have to kind of keep the lines clear. Mm-hmm. Are you talking about your individual... preference as to whether you would want to support this, or if we're talking about the collective, as a collective, should we admonish this person for what they're doing, and should they lose their positions as a result of what they are doing? I think those are two different burdens.
Yeah.
Those are two different layers.
No, I watched.
I feel like there should be a way for him to still create his content without getting any revenue from his creation.
Then what's the incentive for him to create it?
Yeah,
that's up to him. That's up to the writer themselves at that point. But they should have that choice. I feel.
I mean, he does have it. He could open up a YouTube channel and write his own.
People
stuff.
That want to support him have a right to go and support
exactly.
him.
Yeah,
yeah, but now he has to do that off his own.
Now the company does not support him.
Yeah.
The company is a business, and businesses have their own.
The businesses are fucking corrupt, and it's like they're
businesses can be corrupt.
They can be corrupt, but they set their own rules. They can choose to employ who they want and want not to work for them.
Are you going
to
give Hitler a job painting if he's like, I don't hate Jews anymore? It's like, well, there were 6 million of them that died. It's not even the fact that it's like, he didn't technically fuck any of the kids. It's like he was messaging kids with the intention. Not to just I'm gonna
let's
take
go
them
play
out to
video
a picnic.
Games
yeah.
and eat Doritos. Yeah.
Yeah, this is not an innocent thing. That's my point. I have another one, right? Louis C.K. He was not canceled.
Mm-mm.
He went under the radar and lost a couple million dollars for about 2 years, and now he's back and he's successful because.
And he's still a millionaire.
He's still a millionaire, right? So, I understand what he did was wrong, right? He apologized. He owned up to that, right? But I'm like, well, now whoever wants to support him can still support him.
And while it was still bad, it was objectively a less infraction than like what Justin Roiland did.
Yeah.
It was objectively less of an issue.
It was an imbalance of power. He should not have jerked off on the phone over. And again, even him asking to do it was still an imbalance of power because he was a writer. He had the power.
Control. It wasn't consented in good faith.
Correct. So back to Woody Allen. A 56-year-old man going with his adoptive daughter, right? It's said that their first interactions is when she was 17, when she was in 11th grade, and he would take her to her sports games, right?
You know what? Hold on. Just to cut you off real quick, I feel like what I realize it's like, so it's really what it comes down to is whoever people are paying attention to and if it's directly connected to what they are using. Because you said earlier that like there are things that we use that are byproducts of horseshit, right? Yeah.
Well, this is an issue with capitalism.
But yeah, exactly. So what if it's the same thing with content and art? You don't get to see or know who creates it, but it's being produced in the same way. Would you then still feel like those same people would be canceled because they no longer have a platform to like show like, hey, I'm the creator, I'm doing these things,
well, look,
I'm the
one distributing these things. People are monkeys and we're very tribal, so we would still want something to assign it to.
Yeah,
people have been creating gods since the beginning of time, and we would still want to create something to go, I like this cartoon,
actually my biggest argument is that because he's there and he's presented and he's not, and it's not hard to find, you don't have to go and investigate who's funding this program, who's the secret racist that's actually has a malintent behind the reasoning they're funding and programming this organization.
Yeah.
You don't have to do all that. This person's right here and he's telling you he's doing these things. Mm-hmm. So then it's like, oh, now we see him, let's attack him. But then everyone else that's behind the veil, they still get to do whatever they want. It's just people don't want to go investigate those people and don't want to go further down and cancel those people because it's harder to find.
I wouldn't agree with that because there's people doing exposés all the time about people that are under the rug,
like BlackRock.
BlackRock is one of the major ones.
They still have everything.
Yeah, they still have everything because it's almost impossible. Yeah, that's an issue with capitalism. But what you're talking about specifically with individual content creators,
but
there's people like exposing them. Yeah. But here's the thing. Here's the major difference. BlackRock is literally one of the companies of America. It is essentially America.
Right, right.
Let's take another example. Colleen Ballinger. Not exactly America, to say the least, especially when compared to BlackRock. And her stuff wasn't out in the open until an expose came out.
Okay.
So just being behind the veil isn't enough. Yes, us laymen, people who don't, whose jobs or whose identities or stuff like that is directly invested in finding these individuals, we can't all be that. Some of us have to pump gas, some of us have to go flip burgers. We'll rely on people who actually go and do that work.
Okay.
But that doesn't mean being behind the veil is safe. But also, that's the whole point of their job. It's to bring them from the... If they're hiding, like, if there's a Nazi hiding in the basement and you have no idea that he's there, I mean, how can you really
target
him?
You think there's a safety net of some kind that is actively taking all this corruption out of the government? You think there's... So we can just lay back and be...
Now you're going to government.
Now you're going to government. But here's what we're talking about.
Let's say
bad people exist. Let's say, like, Colleen Ballinger before the whole thing. She's behind the veil, right? We don't really know. We don't really... The general public is not aware of her crimes. Mm-hmm. If you're not aware of her crimes, this is the presumption of innocence.
Right.
If no one is aware of the bad things you have done, then you are presumed innocent because it is not good for society to essentially punish people or to reprimand people for something they have not done yet.
Mm-hmm.
However, people whose jobs it is to bring that out of the darkness into the light, that's their job. That's the whole point of them. They're not safe behind the veil. It's just a temporary safety net until someone can actually go bring them out. And then we can be like, hey, what you did was pretty fucking shitty. You probably shouldn't do that. And then they come out with a ukulele song.
Yeah.
I think. Okay, I kind of get it. Your point. Yeah.
That's Brooke till Friday.
Broke till Tuesday.
Broke till Tuesday.
We're broke till Friday. Goodbye, my friends. We'll see you next week. Now I'ma go and beat my meat. And we're broke till Friday. Bye, my friends, we'll see you next week. And now I'ma go and beat my meat. And we're broke till Friday.